Oxnard, California, and the cadets from Garfield, New Jersey. Good evening, everybody. I'm Steve Rondinello, and welcome to a spectacular night of Drum and Bugle Corps entertainment. This is the culmination of a season, a summer full of competitions across the United States and Canada. They're kind of meaningless now. It all boils down to what happens tonight. We have 12 finalists who have qualified from a week-long elimination tournament involving some 65 corps. The cream of the crop, and here to help bring it home to you is Dr. Richard Santo. Dr. Santo's experience in drum corps goes back to 1948 when he started with the Holy Name Cadets, which has since become the Garfield Cadets, the defending champions. You've got to be a proud man tonight, and certainly a lot has changed since you first set foot on a field in 48, Doctor.
Oh, no comparison, Steve. None whatsoever. The art form has just improved to such a point that I think that everyone watching for the first time will be very surprised at what a drum corps looks like in 1984.
It is very different. We're going to get five corps for you in performance tonight, and you're going to get five distinctly different styles, everything from jazz to Broadway choreography.
Absolutely, and what you have to remember are you're looking at the best drum corps in the world. These are the absolute best.
And we have the Madison Scouts on the field now, ready to go for you, one of only two all-male corps left in competition. In the semifinal rounds, they had a 92.6. They are in the thick of the chase here tonight, so let's go down and enjoy the Madison Scouts from Madison, Wisconsin.
On the starting line, from Madison, Wisconsin,
sounds like the crowd is ready. It may be a little deceptive as you look out here on Grand Field, because from our perspective you see the empty stands in the back, but we'll show you some shots as we go through the night. This other side of the stadium is just packed. I would say there are probably 20,000 people here to witness this spectacle tonight, maybe more than that. And they are primed and ready to go for the powerful performance of the Madison Scouts. There you go. There is a throng here. Madison opens their performance tonight with ballet and brass. Keep an eye on this color guard, the rifle line, extremely acrobatic, very physical presentation. We're watching the Madison Scouts from Madison, Wisconsin.
Thank you.
fashion feature to show some very stylized dance steps. This place is on its feet here in Atlanta tonight. We're at Grant Field. The Madison Scouts have just finished their performance. And you can see what effect it had on the crowd here.
Madison sound.
Richard, what a sound.
Yep, the famous wall of brass.
Look at that face. These guys put in a night's work out there. They're given a minimum of 11 and a half minutes, maximum of 13 minutes to perform. And they put everything they have into it in that amount of time. A lot of dance, a lot of emphasis on dance.
Absolutely. We use the term color guard, but we really shouldn't, because at one time the color guard was a part of drum corps where the guard literally did guard the colors. But now that's no longer true. The color guard is really a visual ensemble that becomes a very integral part of the program. You have the brass ensemble, the percussion ensemble, and to it you add the visual ensemble.
Madison certainly does it as well as anyone. As we said at the outset, very physical. The rifle line, the flag line, everyone, great demands on them from a physical standpoint. They have to be in shape as much as any athlete.
Absolutely, absolutely. If you're not in shape, you couldn't possibly finish this season.
Now that's one style. Madison, I guess we could call them wide open. They just let you have it. Well, we've got four more corps to go, and you're going to see a little bit of everything as we progress through the night. You know, a lot of people have come a great distance to see this show. In fact, some from across the Atlantic Ocean. Chris Allen's helping us out down on the field tonight with a look behind the scenes. Chris?
Thanks, Steve. I am standing with probably one of the most devoted drum corps fans I have ever met in my life. His name is Ken Richardson. He's a member of Friends of DCI, the group that helps make this broadcast possible. He and his wife, Patty, are now residents of West Germany, and they have come all the way from West Germany to come to the drum corps show. Why?
Drum Corps is probably one of the most breathtaking musical spectacles that I've ever seen. And I guess I've been a part of the activity since the mid to late 50s, and now that I'm no longer a young man, I can enjoy it once again as a spectator. And it's awesome, once again.
You grew up in Racine, Wisconsin, which is kind of a seat of the Drum Corps activity.
Well, yes, it's for years home of the Racine Kilts, the Racine Scouts, the Boys of 76, and it was just a hotbed of drum and bugle corps activity when I was a boy.
Did you march?
I did. But actually, I marched in a youth band, the Elks Youth Band, but we were always associated with drum corps, and I caught the fever at a young age.
Is it worth the trip?
You bet. We wouldn't miss it. We'll be in Madison next year.
Great. Ken, thanks very much. Ken Richardson, West Germany to the United States just to see Drum Corps. How about that, Steve?
Well, Chris, I don't feel so bad coming from Miami. I guess that makes you feel good about coming from New Jersey.
Absolutely.
I really think.
Drum Corps fans are a special breed, though, aren't they, Richard? You've been around the activity since 48, and they're just a unique kind of person.
Yeah, I think the best thing about Drum Corps fans is they're not afraid to let their emotions tell the Drum Corps how much they like them. They're willing to stand up and clap and cheer and just encourage the young people on the field.
And that's so important because that's the fuel that makes these kids go and do what they do. The people you're seeing on the field tonight range in age, I would say, from 14 to 21. That's the maximum age for a marching member. When you get to this level, the average age about 19 or so?
18 or 19, I'd say.
So these are more mature corps. But again, young people devoting their summers and just about all of their spare time at this level to put on a show that borders on perfection.
Absolutely. You have to remember, these programs started last October. And what we're seeing is the final performance of these programs.
Something that's culminated from a summer-long season of competitions, all coming down to this focal point tonight, a fight for the world title. The corps warming up in the background is the Santa Clara Vanguard of Santa Clara, California. We have four drum corps yet to go, and each of those corps has every chance of winning the title tonight. Santa Clara won a major victory in Whitewater, Wisconsin, and they very well could come from fourth place. It was their quarterfinal position. They could win it all.
Absolutely.
Now, what you're going to see from Santa Clara is an intensely sophisticated program in all respects, especially musically. They're renowned for that. Fanfare and Allegro on the town by Bernstein, and selections from Tenderland. It's incredible what they do on the field.
Absolutely. You have to remember, too, Santa Clara has never missed a final since the beginning of the ECI.
And they have won their share of championships, 1973, 1974, 78, and 81. And they were in the thick of the hunt again last year. New uniforms, if you're a regular follower of the DCI activity, you see the white pants on Santa Clara. Really makes them stand out. And they are going to try to stand out in the standings tonight.
Thank you.
percussion feature. Using the skirts of the color guard very, very effectively, and hand gestures by the horn players. Nice mood established by Santa Clara percussively. Town, Santa Clara, with some music from Leonard Bernstein.
Thank you.
Santa Clara Vanguard from Santa Clara, California. It takes guts to end a show like that. Not the first time they've done it. Every bit as effective. Traditionally, drum corps let you have it with both barrels at the end of their performance. Santa Clara choosing to do a soft down ending.
Yes. You have to remember, I think, that drum corps really is musical theater on a football field. And Santa Clara's trademark is, and was very evident tonight, control. They control the program from the time they go on the field until the time they walk off the field. Every element of that program is totally under control.
Very complex program, very well integrated. Again, we get back to that word coordination. Taking fanfare and allegro and putting it on the field with a choreographic program like that is the project of months of design work, I would imagine.
Absolutely, and a lot of trial and error. They continue to do it until they get exactly what they want musically and visually together.
And they try to hone it as they go through the season. Hopefully, they're peaking at this time tonight.
Hi, my name's Steve Sorrell. I'm a drum major for the Spirit of Atlanta. This is my third year with the Corps. I'm really excited about this year because finals are in our hometown, Atlanta. I'd like to welcome you to Atlanta. I hope you enjoy the show.
My name's John Madden with the Phantom Regiment. This is my second year with the Corps. Last year I enjoyed my participation with Phantom, and that's probably the cause for my return to the Corps this year. We're very excited about our chances here in Atlanta. And we think it's anybody's race at this point, and we're very, very positive about our statement with the Phantom Regiment this year, and we hope we do very well.
My name is Sheila Kiernan. I march with the Bridgemen. This is my second year. I joined Bridgemen. I didn't know what it was going to be like, but I figured out a few things about drum corps since I joined. One of the best things is it keeps you busy doing something you feel like important. A lot of kids spend their summer doing nothing, and I think it keeps me busy, and even though we work real hard and it gets really painful sometimes, it's anything's better than doing nothing, especially this, since it's so important to me.
Hi, my name is Barry Cooper. I'm with the Velvet Knights Drum Bugle Corps. I've been with the organization for 14 years, and for anybody interested in Drum Bugle Corps, it is an awesome experience.
My name is Laura Mallory, and I play baritone for Suncoast Sound. I'd like to say hi to all my friends in Florida. And I'm a rookie this year, and if you're thinking about joining a drum corps, you really ought to go and try out, because it's a great way to meet new friends and learn how to work really hard. And also, it's a great way to tour the country by headlight.
Hi, my name is Linda Havness from the Glassmen. I'm in the flag line. And what I like best about Drum Bugle Corps is the feeling of accomplishment. Though the work may be really hard and the practice is long and tedious and hot, it just pays off in the end, because when you have the feeling of winning or the feeling of your best show, it's you can't even explain it. It's just so great.
Well, Richard and I will second those emotions. In fact, if, let's say if we weren't 21 and a half, just over the cutoff age for marching, we'd be out there again. I did it for about 14 years, and I'm sure you have quite a few behind you as well.
Way behind me.
But those kids are right. It's just a magical feeling, and that's why we've both stayed with the activity and see it as a good avenue for the kids. It's a chance to perform, a chance to excite an audience, and a good way to stay off the street and out of trouble, like one of the kids said.
I think if you talk about excitement, you're about to see a great deal of excitement just about to happen.
Indeed we are. Drum Corps kind of breaks down along regional lines, and there are regional allegiances. Well, this on the field now is the leader of the Midwest. It's the Phantom Regiment from Rockford, Illinois. They were third in the preliminaries with a 95 even. They won the DCI Canada contest, which was a big victory and an upset over the Garfield Cadets, so Phantom is very much in the chase tonight as well. Their big production, the 1812 Overture, which was one of the big hits last year, they've juiced it up even more. Initially, you'll hear Scythian Suite from Prokofiev, Armenian Dances by Alfred Reed, a percussion feature of Triptych, and we give it now to Marcia Hansen, the drum major of Phantom, the only female DM here tonight. Thank you. We are watching the Phantom Regiment from Rockford, Illinois. Big, full brass sound. This is their percussion feature, Triptych. Watch the use of the capes here by the horn line. color, color everywhere.
Screamers from all over the stands.
Phantom Regiment of Rockford, Illinois, the fluorescent regiment this year. Richard, I don't think there's a color they don't use out there.
I don't think so either. There's only one way you can describe this drum corps and the music they play. They're just majestic.
That they are. The 1812 Overture, once again, the big hit for Phantom this year. They have been strong all season long, and another strong performance here tonight. But they are in some tough company with the Blue Devils, Garfield, Santa Clara, Madison. You've got to do a job here tonight.
Absolutely, and every corps here in the last in the next four corps, these four corps, has beaten everybody in these four corps. So absolutely, the contest is up for grabs. It can go either way. The score is close enough. It's going to be an interesting final finish here.
It's that old baseball axiom: on any given day, any given team can beat any other team.
I think it's going to be true here.
That's our case tonight. And we'll be right back for the second hour of this year's DCI Championships with the Blue Devils and Garfield Cadets yet to perform. And, of course, the finale and awards ceremonies. Live from Atlanta, Georgia, you're watching the 1984 Drum Corps International World Corps across the United States and Canada. They're known as Class A or Division II Corps. Well, many of those corps competed here earlier this week in Atlanta. The Class A or Division II Championship, I'm proud to say, going to the Florida Wave of Greater Miami, Florida. Representing their community well, here's a portion of their lightly Latin and tastefully tropical championship-winning performance. See there a sizable margin for the Wave at 94, followed by the Canadian Knights at 85-1, the Diplomats, California Dons from the West Coast, the Northmen from New York State, Ventures, Emerald Knights, and the Kingsmen of California. It was quite a show, and a credit to Division II, the level of competition and the level of performance in that championship. Some 30 corps competed in the elimination in Division II, part of the 65 in the overall week-long elimination here in the two classes in Atlanta. Presentation of the 1984 Drum Corps International World Championships is made possible in part by a grant from the Cook Group Companies in Bloomington, Indiana. We welcome you back to the second hour of the Drum Corps International Championships live from Atlanta, Georgia. We're at Grant Field on the campus of Georgia Tech. I'm Steve Rondinero. With me tonight is Dr. Richard Santo. And so far we have seen some wild performances. We have two more to go yet tonight. And we have two very different styles. The Blue Devils ready to take the field now. Big jazz sound.
Absolutely. Probably the best jazz producing drum corps. I think you're going to find that there is a very successful wedding of the jazz idiom and the drum corps idiom together with the Blue Devils. They just have been able to produce it and turn it into a science.
Talk about a prolific winner. The Devils have quite a reputation. They've won the DCI title in 76, 77, 79, 80, and 82. Off the line with Bacchanalia, followed by Latin Implosion.
Thank you.
tonight. This is the percussion feature, Carnival number 9. Keep an eye on the color guard here. You can see them in the bottom right-hand part of your screen. They become almost like colorful butterflies throughout this production. Maynard Ferguson proud. The Devils playing very aggressively tonight.
Thank you.
We have to turn the headset down here. The applause tonight roaring through the stands. If there has been a criticism of the Blue Devils in the past, it's one that they've made it look too easy, too effortless. They're almost too smooth. No emotion. That was not the case tonight, Richard.
No, they put on a very emotional show tonight. They have I think part of that interpretation comes from their tremendous ability to create a stage presence. When they're on stage, when they're on the field, everyone knows it. You can't keep your eyes from what they're doing. They do it so well, they make it look almost easy.
Smooth, it flows very well.
Jerry Seawright is pretty much the father of this drum corps, and he can't be here tonight because of an illness. But I think after watching this on television, he's going to feel a whole lot better.
And we'd like to join with the rest of our partners in this fraternity and wish Jerry a speedy recovery. And we'd also, well, it's kind of hard to set the stage for you here because the Blue Devils really are a bit of a surprise being in this situation. I think everybody going into tonight expected it to be a race between Santa Clara and Garfield for the title. All of a sudden, the Blue Devils came out in the semifinals just smoking and steamed their way into second place. And boy, judging by tonight's performance, we're going to have a real straggle down to the end.
Yeah, and you certainly can't rule out Phantom Regiment.
Nope.
And you still have to take into consideration, I think, Santa Clara. They did an excellent job tonight. I think basically it can go either way. It's going to be a tight contest.
Well, that of course is the moment of truth, and that is one core away. One of the people who helps put all this together, when you factor this all together, about probably 1,400 kids taking part in this event tonight, and the contest director has a whale of a job, and Chris Allen has him down on the field for us now. Chris.
Well, he's probably been the busiest man in the world this week. His name is Bob Brisky, and he's been DCI's contest director for all 13 championships. Bob, what's it like to stage a contest like this?
Well, it's a tremendous job. We've got to organize many facets to get this operation in tow. We worry about judging, the spectators, housing, everything. The thing that makes it so easy is that we have a local committee who helps us tremendously to get this job accomplished.
How long have you been doing this? You've been doing it for 13 years for DCI, but I know you've been doing it before that.
Well, I used to run a lot of smaller shows in the state of Illinois, Wisconsin, Iowa, and Michigan. But this was a challenge. The drum corps wanted to get something on their own, and so we formed DCI, and this is the biggest championship contest there is.
When was the last time you sat down and watched a drum corps show?
I think I see it on video in a tape show.
Are you a drum corps fan? Do you miss it?
Do I miss playing in it?
Do you miss playing in it?
Oh, yeah, tremendously. But the satisfaction you get just from watching the kids compete and win and lose, it's an emotional, wonderful feeling.
Bob, you've done a great job here again this year. Thanks very much. Steve, busiest man in the world this week.
I would have to say so, Chris. And Richard and I have both worked with Bob Brisky as respective directors of our own drum corps, and we can only... at least in my case, speaking the highest regard for the job he and his committee does.
Nobody does it better than Bob Brisky.
Yep, you're relieved to see those fellas at the gate. You know, everything's under control somehow. Well, this is kind of a sentimental spot for you, I would suppose, a corps that you marched with as a kid and put a lot of your work into as an adult, about to take the field and defend their championship.
It's the last corps this evening. It's the Garfield Cadets. I think we're going to see an unusual type of drill. I think the things to watch for are the continuously changing patterns. It's going to be an interesting show, I think.
A frenzy of movement, I think, is one way to describe it. It never sits still.
Sort of controlled chaos.
All of the music from Garfield's performance this year comes from West Side Story, and it has been put together masterfully. They're defending their championship, a hard-earned title last year. They became the first corps in the history of DCI from the East to win the title, and they'd like to do it twice in a row. They won the prelims with a 97.5, an incredible score. The Blue Devils were right behind them, though, at 96.8, so anything could yet happen tonight. Garfield, a lot of pressure out there. They have to perform tonight. One thing we might advise the folks at home to keep an eye on is the Garfield drum line. I've never seen a drum line have so many demands put on them as marching members.
So the drum line is an integral part of the entire motion of the drum corps. It's a very difficult thing to do, to march as quickly as they do and still play the percussion instrument.
Drum major Richard Armstrong and Dave Lightsey, is the corps ready?
Garfield is ready. Sit back and enjoy. crowd is on its feet. Sound here in the stadium tells the story, doesn't it? Wow.
I got a heck of it. All I can say is wow. Boy, there just was so much going on.
The demands on the individual marcher are phenomenal. It used to be the old days you'd march in a symmetrical drill and company fronts and the like, and now you have to march sideways, backwards, be playing, and not only hold your spacing, hold your coverage, just so much responsibility on the individual marcher, and you're doing it at strange tempos and metric patterns now.
I was speaking about the show to George Zingali, the designer of the show, and what this comes down to is 128 individual drills. Each individual has a specific place he has to be at a specific time, and it's his responsibility to be there. And since the patterns don't form and hold, he has nothing to guide on.
Right.
He has to know exactly where he has to be at any given point on that field.
And if he is not there, there is a tremendous problem. I remember being at the contest in Whitewater earlier this summer, and somebody just apparently lost their footing out there and went down. And when he went down, that triggered a domino a chain reaction with six or seven kids all piled up.
All fell down, yeah.
And that kind of a drill, that can happen. Just
yeah, well, this drill moves that quickly. That could certainly happen without any difficulty at all. The other thing that was very noticeable in Garfield's drill was their effective use of their visual ensemble. They just took this theme of West Side Story and projected it visually. They created a soft understatement when that was necessary. They created a controlled frenzy when that was necessary. I think they did an excellent job and had total control of what went on here tonight.
We've had some tremendous performances tonight. You've seen five of the best, and I'm going to hold with my initial prediction. I think Garfield has successfully defended the title, and we'll see in just a few minutes when we get to the scores. What do you say we meet some of the young people, though, who make this all happen?
Hi, I'm Benoit Glazer. Being drum major of a Canadian corps is a little different. First, 3 years ago, we had to learn American people that we're not Indians. And at last, this year, we get to learn them that we're also good at drum corps. So I hope we enjoy the show here at DCI Championships in Atlanta and have a good time.
Hi, I'm Cindy Tomlinson, and I'm with the Suncoast Sound Drum and Bugle Corps. I'm in the color guard, and this is my first year in the corps. We have a very unique staff who's very dedicated to their work. And the members of the corps, there's such a nice closeness about us. It's being together so much like we are. We're just like family, and it's just great.
Hi, my name is Tim Vanman, and this is Kathy Harwood. And we're both from the Velvet Knights. She's a Melphin DeWest, and I'm a baritone. And I guess I'm speaking for her because she lost her voice. Too much practicing, that kind of stuff. And we'd like to welcome you now to the 1984 DCI Championship Finals in Atlanta, Georgia.
Hello, my name is Jerry Kahneman, and I play snare drum for the Cavaliers Drum and Bugle Corps. I've marched 3 years of drum corps. I'm sorry to say this is my last year because I age out. I'm happy to say I've marched all three with the Cavaliers. I love everything about drum corps. I think everybody should do it at least 1 year. I love performing for all the people, and I'm really going to miss it.
I'm Donna Cousins, and I'm with Spirit of Atlanta. I've been in the drum corps for 3 years, and I really enjoy the activity. This year is probably my best year. I've really come a long way in my own personal ability, and that's what I really enjoy about drum corps, because it makes your own individuality come out. The corps has come a long way in the 3 years that I have been in it. This year is just wonderful. We're doing real well competitively, and it just makes it all more fun. It's interesting to see how the corps has come in the last 3 years, and I'm really excited that finals are in Atlanta.
And we've had a whale of a show here tonight in Atlanta. Down on the field right now, they're awarding individual and ensemble awards, and that is a separate competition unto itself, and the individuals get a chance to excel here on their various instruments, brass and percussion. A great honor, Richard, for these young people to win one of these awards.
This has become a very fast-growing part of nationals. The individuals, there is just so much talent in these drum corps, and they get a chance to compete against each other on an individual basis.
And they're all to be commended. You know, being selected as one of these kids, of course, is very, very special, as one of the top soloists. If you're in the bracket of these corps we've seen tonight, one of the top corps in the world, well, that's not really where the story ends. In fact, it's kind of where it begins. Not on the field in competition, you're off somewhere practicing, eating, or maybe trying to catch a nap. What we've also discovered is that when not in rehearsal as a group, corps members are often found alone or in small groups, practicing, trying to find that extra bit of perfection that will put them over the top. What we've witnessed is an extremely dedicated group of young adults who realize that the corps has to be good to win. And the corps can't win unless each individual member gives it everything they have. They don't want to be the reason that their corps isn't number one. They practice in the heat. They stay up all night, sleep on buses, tour the country, do whatever it takes to make the grade. So it is to all corps members, not just the ones you see here tonight, that we dedicate these sights and sounds.
On the road again. Just can't wait to get on the road again. Life I love is making music with my friends. I can't wait to get on the road again. On the road again. Going places that I've never been. Seeing things that I may never see again. I can't wait to get on the road again. On the road again. Is making music with my friends. I can't wait to get on the road again.
Willie Nelson would apply to drum corps, but it certainly did tell the story there, didn't it? These kids have probably spent an average of 8 weeks at least out of their summer in situations just like that, on tour, on the road, sleeping in gymnasiums, sleeping on their buses. And this is the night when it all pays off for them. In the elimination, of course, as we've said, the 12 finalists made it here to this contest tonight. You've seen five of them. Well, there is a group beneath that that is defined as the top 25. Richard, that's a very prestigious place to be for these corps.
Absolutely. The 25 members now, or members of DCI, are the 25 finalists that came out of the prelims in the last 2 days of competition.
Here you see them, the Troopers, just missing by a few tenths of a point of being in this contest tonight. Bridgman of Bayonne, New Jersey, Eclipse from Quebec, Canada, Avant Garde from New York State, Skyriders from Kansas, the Knights, Geneseo Knights, the Boston Crusaders, and then rounding it out, the Florida Wave of Miami, skyrocketing up to 20th, 21st, the Valley Fever, the Blue Knights of Denver, the Colts from Iowa, the Dutch Boy from the Ontario province of Canada, and Pride of Cincinnati. So you can see what a wide-ranging activity we have in the drum and bugle corps sport. We have corps from the U.S. and Canada. A couple of years ago, Richard, we had a corps come from Japan. Last year, one from England.
It's truly an international activity, and it's becoming more so all the time. Canada, of course, produces its share of drum corps. There are drum corps now in the Philippines. Drum corps become very popular in Japan, England, Holland.
They're all really starting to happen. So it is becoming widespread, of course. This is the focal point, the U.S. and Canada, and tonight, this is it. We want to go back down now field level to Chris Allen, where he is going to take us inside the way that we decide who the winner is here. Chris?
Well, thank you, Steve. There were 10 judges in this contest, and the man who was judging brass on the field is Bernard Baggs, too. Bernie, I guess the first question is, how was the overall performance of our 12 finalists?
Everybody was terrific. It was kind of show that the show actually judged itself more often than not, and you just had a total pleasure of being on the field with them and making sure that you put everybody in the right place because they took care of themselves, and it was just nice to listen to them play and react.
I'm glad you said it was a pleasure to listen to them because I saw you smiling out there a few times as you walk down the brass line. Do you enjoy yourself out there, or do you really have time to think about it?
Oh, immensely, because if you don't enjoy yourself, then you're not being very receptive to all the styles that the corps have. And the best thing of all is that everybody is so different that you actually get off on different things that everybody does without comparing them, but having fun with them also. So it's very enjoyable.
Compare last year, this year to last year. What were the changes? Where could you hear any changes? Where were the areas of improvement?
Everybody is better. The nicest thing of all is that I went out to California in June and saw some of the Western corps. Everybody, barring none, was better than last year early in the year. So it just made everybody feel that the year would be more exciting, everybody would be more impressionable, and everybody would just be more within their own personality. And that was the best thing about it.
Bernie, you've been a judge now for how long?
10 years. 6 years with DCI.
What did you go through to become a judge?
Well, I'm from New Jersey. I'm from the East, which is obviously the East. And you work through your local chapter. You do enough of paying your dues in the early years of playing, of judging around. Then finally, you work in some of the larger shows. And as your reputation builds and hopefully your credibility, you get to judge at this level. And it's really quite impressive to do it because not only do you have the respect of the corps, but your peers.
Steve Briskey was the busiest man in the world this week. These were the hardest working, probably.
They had the pressure tonight, Chris, trying to decide who is the winner. You see all 12 corps coming back on the field, and they just did an outstanding job tonight. You folks at home have seen five of them in competition if you joined us when we came on the air 2 hours ago. The Velvet Knights of Anaheim, California were the first on, 27th Lancers of Revere, Massachusetts, the Crossmen of Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, Cavaliers of Rosemont, Illinois, the Freelancers from Sacramento, California, the Suncoast Sound from Tampa Bay, Florida, and the Spirit of Atlanta, Georgia. Those are the corps that you did not get a chance to see, but they're coming back on the field right at this moment with the other five that you did see, all of them performing here, and this is goosebump time when you see this spectacle of color coming back, and we call it a retreat, but it's not really a retreat. It's the award ceremony. And it, to our way of thinking in the drum corps circle, certainly matches up with the Olympics in terms of the spectacle and the grandeur of it all. These kids have all worked very hard to get here tonight. And the other performers that you did see, the Madison Scouts, the Santa Clara Vanguard, Phantom Regiment, Blue Devils, and the Garfield Cadets of Garfield, New Jersey. Richard, that's got to make you feel good to see that when they come back on the field.
Very impressive sight. Very impressive sight.
We're going to go back down now to Chris Allen, where he is going to speak to one of the men who helps get the Drum Corps around and make the Madison Scouts what they are. Chris?
Scott Stewart is the director of the Madison Scouts. Scott, let's talk a little bit about the logistics of Drum Corps. One of the most asked questions is, what kind of a budget does a corps like the Madison Scouts operate on?
Well, any world-class Drum Corps is going to operate on a budget of $150,000 on up.
Where, $150,000, where does the money come from?
Well, first off, $150,000 is just the beginning. It could go way up from there. It comes from appearance money, from the sale of souvenir items, from the Drum Corps shows that we run ourselves. The members kick in a bit of the money. We run fundraising projects, and the list goes on and on.
Does it ever end?
No.
You not only run the business end of the Corps, but you are also kind of a program manager, hiring staff and things like that, right?
Right, correct.
Where do you go to look for staff?
Well, we're kind of unique in that we look within, for the most part. I guess I feel that our people that have developed through the Corps, I get to know them, I get to see their potential, their capabilities, and they understand what the Madison Scouts is all about. So we basically look within to develop our people. At this point, 17 of our 20-member staff are alumni of the Madison Scouts.
That's pretty amazing. How many miles did the Corps travel this summer?
About 12,000.
How many shows were you in?
50 appearances.
What's that do to the kids involved?
What we try to do is give them a great experience, and I think what happened this summer is everyone had one, so it was a good one for us.
Can't say much more than that. Drum Corps is a great experience for everybody, Steve.
Oh, Chris, we will second that emotion, both of us having done it for a while. It's almost a shame that you have to put a score on these performances and have to declare a winner. And I know you feel very strongly about there being no losers, Richard.
Oh, absolutely. I think that what happens is that one drum corps gets the highest score, but I think everybody wins. I think there are no losers in a drum corps contest. Every kid gets the opportunity to do the best he possibly can, and if he comes off the field feeling that he has absolutely done the best he can do, and that corps feels it's done the best it can do, it wins. It doesn't make any difference what the score is.
You've definitely accomplished something when you feel that way.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
The thrill of the performance, the thrill of being here, that is all a part of it.
Yes, that, I think, is one of the great things about this activity, is it enables everyone to perform to the best of their ability. You don't have to have a considerable amount of talent, just as long as you use that talent to the best you can.
We look down at the field, we see the color guard generally in the front. You're looking at the Freelancers, Sacramento, California, right there. The Division II champion, Florida Wave. And Greater Miami playing all the corps on the field as they take their rightful place here. This is a very, very tense moment. Boy, I remember what it felt like when I was out there on that field as a kid, and you would sweat bullets just standing there waiting to see how you did. Waiting to hear the number that was assigned to your job. We've gotten in philosophical chats and past broadcasts with Maynard Ferguson and Rita Moreno and other co-hosts about the idea of assigning scores to these performances. But really, Richard, the scoring is a motivational factor. It's what helps push the performers, I think.
Well, actually, what it does is give you something to shoot for. It sets a standard. And I think if you look at it from that point of view, it's a good thing. Because there should be a standard that's set and to be broken by another standard. And that's what's happened today. I think when you heard
well, somebody's unhappy with something. They haven't even announced any of the results.
I don't know what happened.
I think they took the Velvet Knights lawn chairs away. Drum Corps fans do tend to be very, very, very faithful to their corps. They have strong, strong senses of allegiance. Not unlike your basic hometown sports fan. And they let their feelings be known. This is a very emotional activity. You see out there about 1,400 young people between the ages of 14 and 21 who have put on a whale of a performance before some 20,000 people here at least on the concert side of Grant Field at Georgia Tech. Many of these kids tonight, while happy to be out here, are also marking what can be characterized as a sad occasion. For many of them, it is their last performance. They age out. They break the age of 21. That means they go on to be instructors or help with management or play some kind of a role in the future development of their corps.
In a sense, this is graduation night.
Exactly.
The drum majors from these units exchange flags. The spirit of Atlanta drum major, Steve Sorrell.
We're awaiting the announcement of the scores. It's a very big job tabulating and putting together the results of all these performances over the course of this evening. You see on the front sideline the drum majors and the leaders of the respective units waiting. We have a presentation of the colors. What's happening here is the Spirit of Atlanta Color Guard is presenting the DCI flag to the Madison Scouts. The championship is going to move locations. Next year at this time, we'll be talking to you from Madison, Wisconsin. Last year, it was in Miami, Florida. It moved to Atlanta this year. Next year to Madison. We'll likely stay in Madison for 2 years, will it not, Richard?
Yes, it usually stays in a championship city for 2 years. The logistics of moving it every year are just too great.
This contest has been held in Denver, Colorado, Birmingham, Alabama,
Whitewater, Wisconsin.
They do try to move it around the country. As we said, we have four corps out there from California. We have a couple representing the East, 27th from Boston, the Crossman from Philadelphia, Garfield Cadets from New Jersey, Madison Scouts, Phantom Regiment, Cavaliers from Rosemont representing the Midwest.
In the South.
Atlanta and Suncoast representing the South. So everybody represented here.
As soon as this is over and the drum corps exit the field, what you have is the most gigantic mob scene that you have ever seen.
Yeah.
Because everybody on that field has made friends in these drum corps, among themselves. And this is their last opportunity to say goodbye.
That's something we should point out. There are intense rivalries out there in the course of a year. These corps go back and forth. It's entirely possible that this title tonight will be decided by a mere tenth of a point. But even at that, these corps make friends amongst themselves, the competitors. A kid from Garfield may have a best friend in Santa Clara by the time the season is over. And that's what it's all about.
Donated by the Band Corps and presented by Barbara Shanson.
Still a series of presentations being made. We'll run through the basic mentality of the scoring for you again. It's done essentially on a scale of 100. There has been a change this year. Whereas before it was almost a punitive type of judging, whereas they would take away a tenth of a point for a mistake, and it was almost a negative approach. It's a positive thing now, and they build the score from 100.
High percussion, the trophy donated by...
Right now we're getting ready to announce some of the caption winners, and this could give you a clue as to who pulls the victory away. Winning the percussion caption, the Blue Devils of Concord, California. Now that bears out the results of the semifinals. The Blue Devils also taking high percussion in the semis. So that looks promising for the Devils.
Hi, Eminem. The trophy donated by Remo and presented by Martha Willis. There's a tie to the Santa Clara Vanguard and Garfield Cadets.
A tie for high visual between the Garfield Cadets and the Santa Clara Vanguard. High marching and maneuvering, or visual, whatever the terminology you care to use, and that forebodes some interesting things. All these things may be giving you a clue as to who pulled it out.
To the Garfield Cadets.
Garfield Cadets winning high general effects. That basically is the showmanship, the way they sold their show tonight. That's a very important caption. You've watched the five corps at home, folks. Why don't you make your own listing, and here we go with the scores and see how you do.
Presented by Steve Nelson to the Blue Devils.
I think that was the award for high brass to the Blue Devils. This is really getting very interesting.
Well, that is the brass award this time around, and three corps have it. They tied Santa Clara, the Blue Devils, and Garfield. So I don't know if they're going to break that trophy into three pieces or how they're going to do it. I would imagine they will send out duplicates once the time comes. But that shows you how tight this competition has the potential of ending up.
Here are the scores.
All right, let's see if we can pick up the scores for you now.
In 12th place, and a score of 83.2. The Velvet Knights.
Velvet Knights, Anaheim, California, the new guys on the block tonight, finishing with an 83.2, good for 12th place.
In 11th place, with a score of 85.6. The 27th Lancers.
27th Lancers of Revere, Massachusetts, finishing in 11th at 85.6.
In 10th place.
They're both in the same
slot. And a score of 86.3. The Crossman.
Crossman from Westchester, Pennsylvania, just outside of Philadelphia. Finishing in 10th at 86.3.
In 9th place. And a score of 88.8. The Freelancers.
Freelancers slipping a spot with straight eights, 88.8 to finish
in
ninth
place, and a score of 89.7. The Cavaliers.
The Cavaliers climb a spot, eighth place, 89.7. They flip-flop with the Freelancers.
In seventh place, and a score of 92.0. Suncoast Sound.
The Suncoast Sound from Tampa Bay. First corps over 90, staying in seventh where they were in the semis, scoring 92 even.
In sixth place, and a score of 93.1, Spirit of Atlanta.
The hometown corps, Spirit of Atlanta, held their ground in sixth at 93.1 tonight.
In fifth place, and a score of 94.6. The Madison Scouts.
The men of Madison staying in their spot from the semis. Fifth, 94.6. That's where they were for the last 2 years, I think.
In fourth place, and a score of 95.6. The Phantom Regiment.
Phantom Regiment, Rockford, Illinois. Dropping a spot to fourth at 95.6.
In third place, and a score of 97.4. Santa Clara Vanguard.
Santa Clara Vanguard picking up some ground on Phantom Regiment, moving into third at 97.4. These are record high scores tonight.
They are high scores.
Two more to go now, the moment of truth. We have the Blue Devils and Garfield left.
We would like to honor our Division II DCI champion, the Florida Wave championship flag presented by Don Passione.
Florida Wave of Greater Miami being awarded the championship flag now for winning Division II. And believe me, this is a bit of tension release here. These corps are waiting, and these people are waiting now to see what happens between the Blue Devils and Garfield while acknowledging the triumph of the Florida Wave in Division II.
In second place.
Here we go.
And a score of 97.9. The Blue Devils.
The Blue Devils, second place, 97.9. That means the Garfield Cadets have once again won the DCI championship
in
title.
In first place with a score of 98.0, the Garfield Cadets.
Garfield by a tenth
of a point.
A tenth of a point. One tenth of a point, deciding the winner tonight. And it is the Garfield Cadets for the second year in a row and a record high score of 98. Mind you, this is based on a scale of 100. Inflation is everywhere.
Six tenths between the first three drum corps.
Richard, look at those faces on those Garfield Cadet girls.
That kind of tells it all, doesn't it?
Tells it all and then some. Being awarded the championship medallions, there's a championship trophy. And with that, our job tonight is done. We hope you have enjoyed the spectacle that has come out of Grant Field here at Georgia Tech University in Atlanta. It has been a super night of some exquisite performances.
Absolutely.
We catch our breath now and bid you adieu and thank you for joining us. On behalf of Dr. Richard Santo, I'm Steve Rondinero. We'll see you next year from Madison, Wisconsin. Thank you and good night from Atlanta.
The Velvet Knights of Anaheim, California. Star of Indiana from Bloomington, Indiana. The Troopers of Casper, Wyoming. Spirit of Atlanta from Atlanta, Georgia. Phantom Regiment from Rockford, Illinois. Suncoast Sound from Tampa, Florida. The Cavaliers of Rosemont, Illinois. The Madison Scouts of Madison, Wisconsin. The Blue Devils from Concord, California. The Santa Clara Vanguard from Santa Clara, California. And the Garfield Cadets from Garfield, New Jersey. Hi again, everybody. I'm Steve Rondinero, and welcome to our 1985 broadcast. 12-